Okay, welcome everyone on the, another DELAB talk. My name is Łukasz Jonak. I'm with DELAB Digital Economy Laboratory of University of Warsaw. And today we'll be talking about blockchains, their prospects, their understanding. And well, about blockchains, it's easy to say what they are technically, kind of. We have good idea what blockchains are. We know that blockchains are kind of databases. There are databases, there are ledgers, but they are not like server-based ledgers. They are distributed, they are secure, they are immutable most of the time, sort of. And that, those features make them ideal for building, for example, currencies on them, like in case of Bitcoin. But they can be much more than that. The Ethereum project added a computational layer on top of, or in addition to the layer of storage, and that adds to the range of options of what can be built upon this layer of just storage and database and memory. And so this is from technical point of view, what they are, how are they built. But then we've got a social and business aspect of what they are and what they mean and what could be their impacts on society and business. And it's much, much more difficult to say what they are, what their prospects and possibilities are. Because they are kind of like Wild West. They are like area or land which is still uncharted, unmapped, unparcelled, and even the very landscape of blockchains is shifting right now, right? So technologically, this land is still settling, and politically as well, as we can see right now in Bitcoin, there's a lot of turmoil in governance of Bitcoin right now. But still, right now, new settlers, pioneers are rushing into this new land, right? They just rush to claim their land, resources, and start building their life, their enterprises, their companies. And those first pioneers will define, they will build an infrastructure that the next pioneers, the next settlers will build upon. So these first pioneers, the first settlers, the first entrepreneurs will define kind of the ways in which ecosystems of blockchain-based services, businesses, solutions will look like. So it's the best way to actually explain what blockchains are and what can they mean for all of us is to ask actually those pioneers. And today we have with us, we have two of those pioneers that are actually starting to build on this new land, digital land of blockchains. And they are Julian Zawistowski from Golem Factory and Maciej Opiński from UserFeeds, and they are both co-founders of CEOs of those companies. And from also we've got Grzegorz Kapkowski in the audience from UserFeeds, and we'll ask them what their understanding of blockchains is and what's their idea of building on the blockchain. So first I would like to ask those two gentlemen to tell us about their understanding of blockchain and to explain us what they're doing there. After that, after their presentation, we'll have kind of short panel and we'll transition into questions from the audience. So first I would like to ask Julian here to tell us and to explain to us what blockchains are and what he's building on the blockchain.
Okay. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Happy to be here with you this evening. So I think that the definition already given of blockchain is pretty accurate one. So basically, this is a database. And this is, I think, the most important point, that this is a database. But database with very special properties. So first of all, this is decentralized database. So and it is truly decentralized, because if you hear about cloud, for example, cloud is not decentralized. Cloud might be distributed. For example, that computing you need or your data is stored on the different machines, even in different locations. But still, this cloud is managed by a single authority, cloud provider or company that rents this cloud to offer you services. So basically, even if this data is at a time point controlled only by you, by the access, still, this is like a huge single point of failure, you or anyone else in charge of this database. And that has profound implications on how businesses are organized, how social life around that is organized. So I would say that the most important property of blockchain is that this is decentralized, that access rights and modification rights are clearly defined and are not attributed to any single entity. How they are attributed to user depends on technology. That might be like very simple solution, like Bitcoin, for example, where you just hold token, and this token is actually a record in this database saying that this particular balance is attributed to this particular public key, and you control private key that enables you cryptographically making use of this Bitcoin is attributed to this address. And that might be very much more complex. Ethereum was mentioned here. So Ethereum is like this database with logic incorporated in the form of smart contract. So not only you are able to do something with the database, but also you can code in this database rules for something to happen in this database if, for example, somewhere else in other database on this blockchain, something happens. So you can, in fact, for example, it's possible to code a stock exchange in that, or many, many other interactions that now needs a centralized party can be coded in a truly decentralized way, which might eventually lead to a transition where, in many regards, how our technology used by institutions is no longer led by any central authority that says that this should be done this and that way, but rather by software upgrades. Of course, software upgrades that everyone has to agree on, like every player. Okay, every player. Oh. Every player has to agree on this change and adopt the software, but that this is like change driven purely by software. And what we, so yeah, I think that's enough of the definition, and now I will try to explain you how we try to take advantage of this technology, building a very special thing which we call Golem. Golem is the name after Stanisław Lem novel Golem 14. You might remember, or rather Golem 14. You might remember that novel. This is about artificial intelligence, like a military supercomputer that eventually becomes super intelligence, gives lectures on humanity, and then like collapses in its own singularity. Golem is not designed to be something like that. Golem, in fact, is rather to resemble something described in other Lem novel called 137 Seconds. It is not a very well-known novel, so you may have never heard about it, but then it doesn't make a good name of a project, so hence the Golem project. Yeah, and you will know after my presentation. I hope you will know what Golem, what Lem described in 137. It is actually a short story, not a novel.
Yeah. So what is Golem? Golem is a very straightforward complex concept. If you're familiar with things like SETI at home or Boeing or Folding at home or many other decentralized or rather distributed computing projects, this is quite what we try to achieve in Golem. So we want to be able to distribute any computing task over machines connected to the network, like any task on any machines. You just connect to the Golem network. Golem network is peer-to-peer network. It uses like the infrastructure we use for the internet, so no new fiber optic lines needed. But we connect computers in a very special way that this is like a peer-to-peer network without central hubs, without single points of failure. This is this kind of network which is used, of course, in blockchain technology. Also, if some of you came across things like BitTorrent, that also use peer-to-peer technology. So and basically what it will consist of is just a piece of software running on user machine, which enables this user both to rent computer or use others' computers for money to do the computing. And there is no blockchain in what I have described so far. Why we need blockchain? As you may recall, I said that thanks to blockchain technology, we can build systems that are completely decentralized, that run independently of any institutions and entities. So blockchain basically makes a good transaction system. In fact, that might be interesting for you that one of the drivers of Bitcoin research and adoption was crisis of 2008. And Bitcoin was seen then as an alternative to potential alternative to world financial system. So we use Ethereum blockchain for transaction system, also for some other features, but transaction system is most important. Everything else happens off chain, how it is said in this community. So it doesn't need blockchain technology. It happens independently of blockchain. That means that basically this is the centralized network where anyone can take any role, but of course we have, broadly speaking, we have requesters, so those are users who need a lot of computing power. We start with something which is called high throughput computing, so we believe that at least initially our requesters will be people who, for example, do computer graphics with a lot of rendering, scientific computation, financial market analysis, big data analysis, and so on and so on. Like anything where you really need a lot of CPU or GPU cycles to do the job. Then you have providers, so those who give the computers to the network. So they are supply side of the market, and they just have to keep their machine on. And of course we assume that like anyone can be a provider, which means especially that professional data center companies that are cloud providers at the moment also can be providers. So we believe that what we build is a market. And we hope that this market will be used by the players who are on this market at the moment as well. Perhaps for many use cases, they will be predominant providers. Not every use case is suitable for your home laptop. And then very important part of the ecosystem are of course developers, because if we claim that we build Golem, which is a supercomputer, then you usually focus on hardware and you let the others develop the software that runs on the computer. So we don't want to integrate every possible use case on the network. We are starting with some initial use cases just to create the market and so the feasibility of the idea. And we start with rendering with computer graphics, because because of many reasons. First is that there is an already existing, well-established multi-million market for that. Then this is kind of cool because it is easier to visualize results of computer graphic rendering than, for example, of protein folding. Like, of course, protein folding can be visualized as well, but it is not that cool. And of course, the question is why to do that? Why to bother? And we believe that there are many reasons. So, and the first is that we hope that thanks to Golem we will change the way the computing market is organized. I don't want to dig into details now, but this is quite strange market at the moment because this is both quiet monopolistic market. This is a kind of monopolistic competitive monopolistic situation with just as four major players having the very dominant role, and then a lot of smaller players, and which might sound surprising, this is the market with a lot of unused computing power, which to many sounds like something that shows that our idea has no sense at all, and we believe that this is why this idea makes a lot of sense, because if there is a lot of unused power on monopolistic market, that means that there is a huge potential to bring the prices down if only you give if only you make the market efficient, more efficient, and that's exactly what we want to do. Another, I think, very, very interesting thing is that thanks to what we want to do, we hope to eventually turn computing into commodity. So this is like electricity. You don't care what electrons you get at your home. You might care if this is like a green energy or not, but this is like somehow measured on the macro level, and on the micro level you don't care if this electricity comes from this power plant or other. This you don't have to care about that. And I bet that most of you haven't tried to rent any cloud instances. But this is not that simple as buying electricity. And then eventually we would like to make it even more abstract. So if you think about that, like, hardware is irrelevant at all. Like, what is relevant is software. And every use of hardware is the use of software. So eventually, by bringing software on the platform as well and connecting that into our business model, we effectively want to get rid of worrying about hardware altogether, that you always only use software and pay for use of hardware is part of using of software. And of course, I'm all the time talking about use cases where you need something external to your computer, not your favorite Minesweeper game. Something is missing here. But also, why this is important, I think I got rid of this slide to make the presentation shorter, but actually I think this is important, so I'm going to tell you that anyway. And another thing which is quite important, that eventually things like Golem alone not, but things like Golem and other blockchain technologies and further development of peer-to-peer protocols, so the ways computers are talking to each other in a decentralized manner might actually repair internet. Because if you are not like deep into the topic, you may not realize that, but for many reasons, internet is considered to be fundamentally broken in many different ways. Both in how it works on economic and social level, but this is something that Maciek worries about, and he will be talking about that in a minute. But it is also broken on an infrastructure level, on a hardware level. For example, you might have heard about the distributed attacks on DNS servers that are happening like every couple of weeks recently. And this is basically hackers being able to turn off part of the internet. And not really, they are not really turning off part of the internet, they are just turning off part of the infrastructure of DNS servers. So the servers that tell other servers what is the IP address of the web page you want to visit or of the service you want to visit. And then the service is actually working, everything is all right with the service, but you are still not able to connect with the service because you have only learned wyborcza.pl. You haven't learned like 192 point something to access that. And there are many other things that are like case for concern in how it works. And the centralized architecture of internet might be ultimate solution to that. Also to things like censorship, state control over internet. Of course, this is like, there are two sides always. If our project and other projects like that succeed, that it will be much harder to track down terrorists, for example. By reading their emails, but still, like people working in those technologies, like we believe that freedom is more important than that, and there are other tools to contain those dangers. Okay, why now is maybe I will just summarize just to make it shorter that we believe that Golem is possible now for a number of reasons, but blockchain technology is one of them. That you are able to create autonomous machine-to-machine operations, including machine-to-machine transactions, and that's it. okay. We came across quite often question. I don't know why. How is it possible that this kind of project is conducted in Poland? And like this is mostly coincidence. So no good news here. I don't personally regard Poland as a significant blockchain hub or even IT hub, a part of very good subcontractors to Western companies. But basically we are like mostly Polish product, not only, and of course financing is international, but team is like 90% of the team is based in Warsaw. Then there is also like an interesting fact. So basically this is probably why I'm here talking to you now, because otherwise organizers wouldn't hear about us. And you haven't heard us about us mostly because we try to keep low profile. So, but why I'm here, I'm going to tell you the story. So we managed to fund the project through the crowdfunding on blockchain. So this is another cool thing you can use blockchain for. And we conducted something which is called crowdfunding on the Ethereum blockchain. So, like for most people, that could happen on Mars as well. This is like a very specialized thing for a special group of people. But still, we were able to gather like equivalent of $8.6 million in 19 minutes in this crowdfunding. Of course, this is not like I will answer your any questions about that, how to price $8.6 million in 19 minutes. That wasn't really 19 minutes. That was something like 2 years of preparing everything, like working on the project before, being part of this community, and only like the process of crowdfunding on the blockchain took 19 minutes. And would be two if not for the failure of the centralized servers, which were overloaded by the transactions incoming to us. So I guess this is it in nutshell. I invite you to golem.network page to learn more about the project. If you would like to help us, we are running live testnet, so everyone can install Golem right now and see how it works. Perhaps you would better wait for the next week, because we are preparing new version with a lot of new stuff to be released sometime next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Ulek. We will be saving questions for later. And now, Maciej, please.
Can we switch the presentation, please? It's going to be like on the white background, so it should be easier to see. Hello, everyone. My name is Maciej, and I'm a co-founder and CEO of UserFeeds. With UserFeeds, we're building a set of technologies for what we call tokenized ranking algorithms. I'm going to talk about this, and I'm going to explain. I know it sounds mysteriously, but I'll try to explain what we mean by that. As Łukasz asked me to just do this short introduction, how we think about the blockchain technology itself, and what is the fundamental breakthrough in there. So I'm just going to maybe start with that. And I'm going to take a different angle that Julian did. Because if you think about the car and the invention of the motor engine, you can look at the part itself. Or you can look at the car, you can look at the wheels, you can look at all the internal stuff that's in there. But it's not going to help you predict the change in how cities are shaped, what people consider status symbols, and all these interactions that the car technology had with the environment. Because the real impact of the car was, and so you cannot predict what happened in the society, but by looking at the parts. And the same with the Bitcoin technology and all these blockchain technologies that evolved after it. So basically, the way I think the most important thing about all this set of technologies is that suddenly Bitcoin proved that it's possible to influence human behaviors using economic incentives embedded in an open source software and to achieve sustained economic coordination. Because suddenly we have these tools, these technologies that create these fictional tokens. Bitcoin is a token, and there's all sorts of other tokens like Ethereum and like Ether and all the other ones that we can create on top of Ethereum. And what these tokens do, they basically make people do stuff. You know, you can program a code, upload it on the internet, and suddenly you can achieve economic coordination between people who never met each other all over the globe because they want to get these tokens. And this is, you know, on one hand, this is nothing new. People did stuff for money always. People organized themselves around fictions like, you know, corporations and nation states and so on and so forth. And with these technologies, we can get these kind of, we can say, new type of fictions, these imaginary tokens that exist on the blockchain, but because of the underlying technology that Julian described, that it's decentralized, it has all these cryptographic proofs in it, so we can trust it, or we don't have to trust it. We don't have to trust anyone, so we can look at the blockchain and agree on the certain state. Because of that, suddenly these tokens have value. So you've heard that, you know, Bitcoin went up from nothing to $1,000, and now you have Ether going up, and all these other tokens that people want to have and speculate on. And this is the fundamental breakthrough, because suddenly a 15-year-old with a laptop and an idea can come up with a mechanism that will coordinate people economically and actually make them do stuff. They will burn electricity, mine tokens, they will say things, they will think about things. Suddenly Bitcoin is undermined because they can earn Bitcoins by, you know, mining, for instance. So after this short intro, I'm going to tell you how we want to leverage these technologies to build what we call like these attention marketplaces, essentially. So if you look at the state of the internet today, if you use social media, if you use a smartphone, essentially if you get information from the internet about the world around you, your perceptions of the world, images you have in your mind, are being shaped by the electronic rectangle you carry in your pocket. And there are pixels in this rectangle, you call it a smartphone, these pixels create all these images, and you this is news for you, or what your friends are doing. Basically, you get information from this. But essentially, where this information is coming from, who is mediating contact with your friends, with the news agencies, with web portals, bloggers, and so on and so forth, are these companies. Companies like Google, Reddit, Twitter, Facebook, you know, whatever. You probably use some of these services if you use the internet today. And your attention and the importance of information that you are receiving every day, because your attention is finite. So you only have like, you know, 12 hours a day of waking, like maybe a little bit more if you sleep less, but your attention is finite, but the information that is competing for your attention is growing exponentially. There's more and more competition, and everybody feels that there is so much information overload, and the competition is getting fiercer. There's more competition, everything is becoming more scandalous, clickbaity, there is scandal everywhere. Why is that? That's the effect of the competition for your attention. But in the middle of that, you have these closed data silos of companies that actually make money from these network effects created by us. We create information, other people want to pay attention to it, and they make money by selling access to this data. And we think that such diverse problems as fake news, hate, clickbait, or other things like online governance and politics online, or advertising relevance, targeting, are purely information ranking problems today. It's what information, given that your attention window is finite, the question is, what's going to be on top of the list? And if you can get on top of the list, this is extremely valuable. So in the 21st century, in the economy we're living in, attention is becoming more and more relevant with all the automation that's out there. The only scarcity, the most important scarcity, is our attention, because if you can get someone's attention, you can make them buy, you can make them vote, you can make them react to stuff. So the control of the ranking algorithms translates to the huge economic power. And as the last elections in the US and elsewhere can show, it's also a political power. Because really, by controlling the ranking algorithm, by selecting what people will see, you can shape their perception of reality, really. And if you look at the concept of the advertising, and I'm going to give you a definition that you've probably never heard of before, of what really advertising platforms are. Advertising platforms are really platforms for content ranking algorithms, which use US dollars or euros or Polish zlotys that are paid to the platform owner as a ranking signal. Basically, the way Google makes money is like, okay, so you know, you can have this, you can go to the Google search engine and you can search for stuff, and there are results ranked by the Google algorithm, the organic algorithm. But there is another ranking algorithm on top, which works like, if you pay us money, we put you on top. And basically, because of the network effects that are there, these companies get extremely wealthy because there is so much attention going through them. The more attention is coming through their systems, the better the systems get. So the more people use them, the more you can charge for advertising, because there's more attention that people will pay for. And as we already know, attention is valuable. So the question is, could we build ranking algorithms that would allocate attention using signals that we can all own somehow? And I'm leading to the question that, can we do maybe for ranking algorithms, which we already know that are so important, can we do something for ranking algorithms that we can do for money? Basically, can we decentralize them in a way that people who contribute to them, people who work to achieve these network effects, can get rewarded in a similar way that early adopters of Bitcoin who helped grow the network are being rewarded when the network really achieves success. We really think that the tokens, the concept of the token, that as it is understood today, this is only a tip of the iceberg, because as we understand tokens today, we really think of them as money or assets or shares. We think of them in a very traditional metaphors that we know from the previous era. But what is interesting about them, before we go to the other metaphors we'd like to propose, is that tokens prove that suddenly it's possible to have these new types of business models where you don't have to lock your data in the silo. You can have an open data. Bitcoin is an open data. You can have an open source code base, but using the token that is inside there, like the token that coordinates everyone economically, suddenly you can have this economic moat. By economic moat, it's like it's this barrier to entry. It's like you can copy the Bitcoin code, you can read all the data, but to actually participate in the consensual Bitcoin network, you need to buy Bitcoins. Because there is already a network effect around it. So everything can be open, you don't have to hide anything, but still there is this economic moat around it. Because now Bitcoin is $1,000 if you want to join the network. You know, a couple of years ago it was cheaper, so there is this natural moat. And what is interesting, that users of this network are stakeholders in the network. So they have an economic incentive to coordinate themselves in a way that the network grows and the token becomes more valuable. So suddenly users, there's no company in the middle. Everybody's a stakeholder. If you buy Bitcoin, even to send it to someone, for the time you hold it, you are a stakeholder in the network, because the network can, like the value of the Bitcoin can go up or can go down. So what we are working on, so our idea is that this is the AdRank algorithm. AdRank is like the algorithm Google uses to rank AdWords ads, the sponsored links you see on the engine. And I'm just using this as an example. So right now, AdRank is it's like CPC, cost per click you are willing to pay Google, and quality score, which is like a bunch of signals that, it's like the click-through rate and a bunch of other signals that you can, Google uses to determine the relevance of your ad. Our idea is like, what if Google suddenly started using your token holdings? That the token you have, you can prove to Google that you own a specific token, and Google would increase your ad rank because of that. So the token is the third signal. But because the token can be bought and sold on the market, like you can buy the token. Imagine if Google in 1998 was selling token per each keyword, and you could buy them. And you can hold them like you hold Bitcoins today. And Google told you, look, instead of having ad rank with these two CPC and quality score, we would have this third factor. We would have a token. And you can sell it on the market, you can keep it, but you can also use it in the auction to modify your ranking. So basically, if you have a token, and if you bought it earlier, you can, with a token, you will always be a bit higher than the competitor without the token. So how would you estimate the price of how much would you pay for this price? What factors would you consider when determining the fair price? The factor you would consider would be the attention on this keyword. If you think that there will be a million people searching for this keyword, this token would be valuable, just by the sheer fact of being used by Google in ranking in the search engine. Why? Because attention is, if you think that people will pay with US dollars for CPC, like they will use US dollars in the ranking, and of course Google does it every day, so if you think that there could be a token in this ranking, and of course, token is something publicly visible. It's just a piece of data in the database that everybody can see. This token would become very valuable if somebody would start using this for ranking, because as we know, attention is finite. The same for Facebook, and this is the, I'm using the Facebook EdgeRank. EdgeRank is not being used anymore on Facebook, but Facebook uses like, you know, affinity for ranking, like, you know, what you should see on your newsfeed. So it's a bunch of signals, you know, how close you are to a person, how many likes the piece of content got, so on and so forth. So imagine that if we added token here as well, so suddenly, even if Facebook was still a centralized service, but they use the tokens, they could release the tokens, and like you could buy into our algorithm. It would be like you could speculate by buying these tokens how popular Facebook will get in the future, and by how popular will be how much attention people will be paying to this, because this would be also valuable. And there are many interesting implications of this, because if there are groups of people who are working around, who are holding this token and are part of this economic network, they have an incentive to make this network more valuable. So they would automatically become Facebook advocates. If you look at the Bitcoin community, people are tattooing Bitcoin on themselves, you know, telling all their friends about how great Bitcoin is. No one is telling their friends how great Facebook is. Everybody hates Facebook, they use it, but they have this love-hate relationship with it. No one is going around and advertising for Facebook. With these mechanisms, we believe that you know, the business models that we know of today can be really modified. Because the business models today for publishers, media companies, and platforms are like this. You either sell advertising or you sell subscriptions. These are the two predominant business models, with the advertising being really the dominant one. We think, and we all know the problems that are related and conflicts of interest and the opacity of the entire business of these two business models. We think that with the tokens, which really represent access to the attention of a specific network, and this access to attention is realized by being used as a ranking signal, as a ranking algorithm signal, we can create something new. Maybe not even something new, something that exists today, because really US dollar is a token. It's just a token that's being widely accepted and recognized by everyone. But in the same way we are today using US dollar as a signal for the advertising algorithm, we can use these tokens that everybody can issue out of thin air, and they can just get value by having these network effects. So this is the... This is what we are actually working on a set of technologies, like an engines, that would allow you to run these algorithms that on one hand can be totally customized by you. You can come up with any algorithm you want. But on the other hand, they can plug into these blockchain-based networks and listen for signals from the tokens. And the issuance models for the tokens can be also customized in many different ways. But what we're building is an engine that can power all these algorithms and allow these new methods of discovering information. And we think that, first thing, it can allow us to have new ways of allocating attention, because if the algorithms change, what we pay attention to changes. So it's like our perception of reality will change. And we want to allow these new business models to emerge, because advertising is broken. We've reached the peak of advertising, and everybody's searching for an answer, but no one has good answers yet, we think. We have one of the answers. So, and the blockchain technology is something that enables us to work on ideas like that. Without it, with this economic coordination, and this interesting things that token do to people's minds, because when you own a token, you change your attention to the token, it would be impossible. So if you're interested, please sign up to our newsletter, userfeeds.io. There is a newsletter, we'll be sending updates. Right now we're in the kind of very infrastructure stage, we're building the engine, but we'll be sending updates to our community. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Maciek. And maybe, Julian, can you please join us for questions? So let's actually start with the questions, if there are any, from the audience. And then we'll see how it goes. Does anybody have a question for our speakers? Yes, please.
Should we sit here? Or?
I think that's going to be my first question. So my first question is, do you actually develop the software in-house, or do you employ or just work with some subcontractors?
Who is the question for?
Well, both of you.
Sure. We develop it internally. This technology is, as much as we wanted maybe to use subcontractors for some components, it's a breakthrough, it's such a new technology that it's very hard even to hire people just for the company. We hope that in a few years, that once the technology matures, it will be able to outsource parts of it. But if you're a contractor that's providing, you know, blockchain development services, we'd be happy to talk to you.
Yeah, well, we have a team of 12 developers at the moment, working in-house. We have office close to Metro Wilanowska. We also work with the Australian company that is our contractor for product design, computer graphics, user experience, user interface. And yeah, well, there are decent Polish companies doing this kind of stuff, but we decided to work with that company because we worked with them before, and they have experience with blockchain with blockchain technology and for blockchain user experience and user interfaces are one of the worst design parts of the technology. We also work with one developer who is hopefully building a team around him for peer-to-peer networking in Zug, Switzerland. And also, like, this is open source project, so we also take advantage of many, many technologies already existing. If we were to build everything from scratch, including Curium, that wouldn't be possible.
For the recording.
Yeah, my question is, how do you think the tokens will face the problem of hoarding? For example, you mentioned that the value of token like increases by time. So, like people would probably like try to hoard like their tokens. Let's say, for example, bitcoins, until like in the future, and then they sell them for like higher value. So. How do you think, how people should, how do you think they will be incentivized to sell their token, like, without, you know, deflationary value, if you get my question.
So, you know, I think I understand your question. So it's a very broad question, because different tokens have different economic mechanisms programmed into them. So for Bitcoin, mechanism can be like this. For another coin, it might be different. But of course, there is, like, you know, people are natural speculators. So they will try to work. You know, these systems work because everybody optimizes for their own economic interest. And somehow, because of all these interests and the incentives in the code, the system stabilizes, finds an equilibrium somewhere. So you cannot prevent hoarding. And I think hoarding is a part of the, it's an expected behavior. Some people will hoard. When the price goes up, they will sell, so the price will go down. So maybe other people will sell. So it's a system of relationship. But I don't think it's a negative aspect of these systems. It's just part of it, because others will be buying and selling, and the system will find an equilibrium somewhere.
Yeah. So quite honestly, I'm quite skeptical about tokens in general. Probably we differ with Magic on that. So, although like we take full advantage of the token economy and how it works, I believe that at least at the moment this system is very, very immature, very volatile. And of course, like this is somehow good, because that brings a lot of interest to blockchain technology. I don't think that there were no engineer seminars on TCP/IP protocol like decades ago, which is basically one of the things that made the internet possible. And I believe that the blockchain is a very technical stuff, in fact. Of course, once you translate what is possible thanks to that on actual use case like Maciej does, then this is something to talk about. But then Maciej is actually talking about attention economy, not about blockchain. and enabled by the blockchain, but still like when you like in 90s where internet mania started, people were talking about everything that is possible thanks to internet, not necessarily about protocols that may made internet possible. So I would say that this token economy is byproduct of the technology, because it makes it possible. And of course, like honestly, the technology Bitcoin was designed as a new money. So this is somehow pretty related. Still, I believe for a system like Golem, I believe that the way forward is to use that as a there is a nice term used in blockchain space as a transaction rails. So you use the token to do the transaction, but in fact, this is like a database. The database you can have a part of ownership in by owning token, but in fact, how the token price change doesn't really matter, because if you want to exchange pure for apples, that only like relative price of pures to apples matters. And if you then decide to express that in Bitcoin or with dollars or with Polish zloty, then the spot price doesn't matter, as long as you are able to conduct the transaction in a way that you are not exposed to exchange rate risk. And for example, the same is true for Bitcoin. If you for example, use Bitcoin for remittances or for international transfers, as this is used, then like the hoarding and the changes of prices are not that important, as long as you're able to secure for this spot exchange risk.
No, I think we don't have a disagreement here. Like, you know, yeah. It's just a different ways of looking at the different angles of looking at the problem. So no.
Okay, so we had first we had
questions right here on the phone. Is it on? Okay. I have a blockchain related question, not really to your businesses, but reading about blockchain and how transactions happen, and also Maciej, you mentioned something about mining. Could you explain to me, I don't really get the concept of blockchain miners and what they do and what they get paid for, and yeah.
So very generally speaking, if you want to have a network of people that don't know each other and don't trust each other, to come to a consensus, they have to agree globally what is the current state of the network, and what transactions happened, in what order, and how they affected the state of the network. So basically, they have to agree how many bitcoins everyone has, just to, you know, simply speaking. So for them to come to this agreement, they have to sacrifice something valuable. And in the case of Bitcoin, this valuable good that they have to sacrifice is the electricity. And then they by sacrificing electricity, it's an economic expense for them, which is external to the system. And they can, in a way, they vote with this electricity, with this hashing power, for what is the actual state of the network. And because of these incentives, it's like, because they already take a cost, so it's in their incentive to make Bitcoin valuable, so it's not in their incentive to lie about it. So they, that's how this consensus works. And I know it sounds very abstract, but it works in practice. Like people, these incentives are really powerful. So this is mining. This mining is really burning electricity to be able to vote on the actual state of the network, include transactions into the blocks, and then for this work, they get rewarded by new tokens from the issuance. And the protocol rewards them for this work. If you have a Visa can hire IT managers and build infrastructure, because there is a company in the middle. The Bitcoin has to bootstrap this infrastructure somehow. So this is what miners are for, and the rewards for miners. And that's why mining is profitable for so many people.
Yeah, I can try a little more technical description if you want. So like basically blockchain is every block is a set of transactions like that happened in a given period of time, or rather from the time that the previous block was mined to the time this particular block was mined. So all the transactions that happened in this period of time go to that block. Now, those transactions are just a set of transactions written in that block, like on a bank account, for example. And then you have to create a hash, and this is where cryptography comes in. So hash is a kind of mathematic function that transforms all this information you have in the block into a relatively strong, short string of like numbers, and in Bitcoin, to like mine the block, you have to find a new hash that that meets some certain prerequisites. So finding this hash is mathematically difficult. It can be determined how many operations you have to conduct before you are able to mine. So this is where this hashing power, this
GPU power and this electricity comes in to find this block. And then once you find this block, if you're the first one to find a new hash, then you can decide to include all the transactions that happen at that time. You are rewarded for that by the fee, that transaction fee that comes to you then from those transactions. And on top of that, and this reward is much more important, some bitcoins are created thanks to the creation of this new block. So you also, like, this is an inflationary model, that there is a money creation. You create some new bitcoins.
But doesn't that lower the value of the bitcoin?
Yeah, well, potentially yes, and there are some models even explaining how the cost of mining new bitcoins relates to the changes of price. So eventually there is a relation, but of course the amount mined in every block is small to the total supply of Bitcoin.
And like the case of Bitcoin, the total supply is finite, so eventually there is no loss of value.
Yeah, from time to time the so-called halving happens. So that the reward is from the new block is divided by two. And yeah, that depends on the currency, how this is organized.
Okay, so we have a question back there.
Yeah, I wanted to continue the conversation about the value.
So just wait for the mic, okay?
Oh, okay. So can we just argue, or is it just the fact that the Bitcoin value is basically based on the computing power used to mine it, right? And because we need more and more computing power to mine bitcoins, because the algorithm is built that way that it is mined slower, so we need to use more and more computing power, that's why the value increases. I mean, there are also many factors, but that's why it continuously increases, because we use more computing power to mine by bitcoins, so, you know, it naturally.
Yeah, well, this is,
I mean,
that works like that. So the more miners you have in the system, the more hashing power you need to generate one token. So I would say that this is like self-regulated system. So if the price goes down and mining is no longer profitable, then you can expect some miners to quit or switch to different coins, and eventually mining becomes more profitable. So I would rather say that works like that. And the value, like, okay, I'm going to say that. Like, the value to the coin comes, of course, from Ponzi scheme-like economics. But this is very specific Ponzi scheme, because, like, this is not a poor Ponzi scheme, where you only have those who came first and those who came later, and those who came later are screwed, because there is a very simple way of transferring those tokens between each another. You have all these social additional effects that Maciej described, and the incentives and so on and so on. But if you take like a textbook definition of Ponzi scheme, that at least Bitcoin fulfills all the prerequisites of a Ponzi scheme. But still, this is much more than Ponzi scheme. So this is not, I don't think this will collapse as Ponzi schemes collapses. I think that if Bitcoin collapses in value, it will collapse because of technology failure, not because of the Ponzi scheme like mechanism.
But are the other cryptocurrencies also mined that way, in the same way?
There are very different setups, but basically in Ethereum, in two biggest cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin and Ethereum, that works more or less the way I described. It's a little bit different for Ethereum, but.
Yeah, so the fundamental valuation of these tokens, there is an ongoing debate how to value them. And I'm really glad Julian mentioned the Ponzi scheme term.
It's going to be uploaded, guys, you know.
because but I tweeted, you know, if you look at my Twitter, I tweeted this scientific research on how really networks are being created in nature. Citation networks, World Wide Web, protein networks, and basically fundamentally in nature, the way networks form is like the rich get richer. So there's always a node that gets connections in the beginning, and then as the network grows, the node that already had connections gets even more connections. And this is fundamentally all, if you look at how networks work, this is true for how Facebook emerged, how World Wide Web emerged, but for the first time in the kind of history of technology and economics, we can see these networks being priced on the public markets. Because previously, with like Facebook, when the Facebook network grew, it was valued privately. It was the valuation went up probably similarly, but it was valued on the private market. We didn't see that. You didn't see this jumps in valuation. I essentially think that these tokens, that nature is really a Ponzi scheme in some sort. That's what I think. And these tokens, they reflect the value of the network effect. That was previously there, it was always there, but it was hidden from the plain sight. And now it's in the plain sight and everybody can participate in that. So I think that if we think about how to distribute value from the network effects in the network society, that we are living in a network society increasingly more, these are the mechanisms. Whether they are perfect, whether they are ideal, they also create these elites of very rich people who are holding majority of tokens. So it's not going to be suddenly everybody's going to be equal because of tokens. No, I think they will create more unequal networks. But on the other hand, everybody can create a new token and create a new network where they are the biggest owner. And if they convince everyone, that will be the new 1%. So, you know, it's a long story, but fundamentally, I think it's the way of pricing network effects. And network effects are exponential, so that's why these things grow exponentially. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. My question is about this user feeds presentation. So basically, you promised there is a new business model for content producers, but I still feel a little bit vague about this. I mean, could you walk us through like each step that a content provider needs to do to earn money, to earn his living on his content? Yeah? Mm-hmm. So basically, let's imagine I am a journalist, I write an article and I would like to earn money from it.
No, so I think the fundamental problem we have today is that we think that content is valuable. And in our economic model, we think attention is valuable. And that's a very, and because some content gets a lot of attention and becomes valuable, so some people who produce content, they get a lot of money from it. And it leads to this confusion that content is valuable. But if you think from the fundamental economic principles, if you think attention is the biggest scarcity and content is growing exponentially, AIs will be producing written articles for some types of media. They will be making videos, VR worlds very, very soon, so there will be an abundance of content. So you will be only able to make money if you get attention, and which is something, and of course content is attractor for attention, but it's not value in itself. So what I describe, of course, it was like intentionally very abstract. So what we mean is that today, if you're a creator, if you're an Instagram creator, and you take photos and people follow you. So whatever you create, and you know, we kind of instinctively feel that, oh, okay, so what is so special? She's just taking photos of this or photos of herself. I'm using this Kim Kardashian example. She's a good example for this conversation. So she's a content creator, and she makes a lot of money from this. But she makes money from attention she gets, because there are thousands of similar girls out there who produce exactly the same photos, who are imitating her, but don't get attention. So in our model, people like that, people who are producing something, will be able to have either their own tokens. So instead of being an Instagram creator, you will be a creator that is independent, that will have their own Bitcoin that people could buy into, and people could use this Bitcoin to it's not the Bitcoin, but it's a creator token, for instance, to use this for ranking algorithms. So you'll be able to basically predict, speculate on the attention of a particular creator, because you don't have to create content yourself, but you can try to predict. Like today, if you buy stock, you try to predict whether the company will generate a lot of cash. With the model we're proposing, you'll be able to speculate whether someone will be able to generate a lot of attention in the future, and that will be automatically translated to the token price, you know, in the basic economics of this. So that means that today, if you have a website or a fan page, in the future you're going to have a token, and the community of people that will be able to buy into your token and help you create this network effect. And the token around, the types of content around it could be articles, photos, VR worlds, 3D models, whatever, because the attention is foundational, not the form of content. I don't know if it makes sense, but.
So being a content creator, you'll not only, your responsibility, if you want to earn money, will not only be to create content, but also to kind of engineer kind of like a social token social surrounding that will bring attention to you, right? And the tokens would kind of maybe help you to do that, right? So it's not just creating content, but also, you know, basically kind of engineer your audience with tokens.
Basically, everybody will be their own Facebook. Facebook is not producing any content. It's creating an kind of an ecosystem for others to create. In this model, like Kim Kardashian could create some of content herself, but essentially she will be running her own Facebook with her face on it and incentivizing other people to join her instead of joining 10,000 other creators. And whoever's going to win is going to make money, because attention is going to be finite and everybody will be competing for this attention. So only one creator can be successful out of 1,000 in a specific niche. It can be another niche, but we're going to have this power loss across all these networks, because that's unavoidable. But you will be able to, right now you're trying to predict which cryptocurrency will be successful. And we think this will apply to many more phenomenons, like, for instance, content creation. So you'll be able to predict which content creator is going to be successful. And you can buy the token of them and just tell your friends, like, listen, pay attention to this guy or to this girl. And if they start doing this, they will also want to buy this token, because, like, they will want to be part of it. It's like with Bitcoin. Pay attention to Bitcoin and then you think, oh, maybe I should get some, just a little bit. And then you get more. Because essentially participating in these networks is owning a stake in this network. That's at least how I think about it. Might be wrong though.
When you buy token, you want this token. Okay, so when you buy token, you're counting on the value increase of this token. That's your sole benefit for holding this token. Or you get any other benefits?
So it's like a question, if you go to work and you want your employer to be successful, or maybe you have a startup and you have a share in the startup. So you are feeling that you are part of an economic network, economic entity, and you want it to be successful because it's valuable for you economically, you have more money, but it's also reputation, it's being part of something that grows. So I think human beings are much more complex than just, they're not just like, you know, homo economicus, but this economic drive is really important in there. So I think the phenomenon we're seeing with the blockchains and tokens, it's really a phenomenon where we transition from networks of social relationships that we have with people and friends, and it's all about, you know, it's the different aspect of our humanity, but we also these economic beings who are creating these networks, corporations, startups, companies, universities, you know, there is a value that is being created by this coordination. And now we have a new technology to create the same systems, the same type of systems, but on a much global, much bigger scale. But it's essentially about cooperation and network effects, because in the network age, it's all about network effects.
You are selling us a theory, but you don't give us instructions how to, you know.
No,
because
I'm just.
If you want to have users on your platform, you need to give them instructions, not just a theory.
Yeah. So in terms of in terms of applications, of course, and I totally agree. I'm sharing my observation, and like, you know, if I'm right, maybe like, you know, I'm gonna have some benefit from that, and if I'm wrong, I'm gonna lose time and money and effort, and you know, that's part of this. That's part of being at the kind of. That's part of playing with cutting edge technologies. But essentially, what you're asking are applications. Like, you know, what apps will be possible on top of these protocols? And it's like asking, and it's a valid question, but it's like, we cannot even imagine, like if you had TCP/IP and packet routing technology, it's very hard to predict Facebook from that. Because it's an emergent phenomenon. So right now, everybody in this crypto space, you need to work from the kind of first economic principles. Like, what are the basics of economics that are kind of governing these phenomenons, and trying to kind of make an observation that is accurate, and it works in the real world. Because if you start working on applications and you don't have foundations right, then you're gonna fail for sure. Because And you think, and of course, it is a challenge of these projects, because people are building these protocols, and they expect everyone to build on top of them. And it's you know, Golem has the same problem. They expect people to build applications. We have the same problem. We expect people to build applications on top. We will build some of them, but it's essentially about convincing people to build higher up the stack. So I cannot give you. Maybe I'm wrong, yes, that's very possible.
Where's the ranking element in it?
Sorry?
The ranking element.
Where is the ranking element?
Yeah,
so the ranking element is that, as we said, that if you think that attention is scarce, and we think that we can all agree on that, and if we see that Google makes money because it can charge money for accessing a certain interface. So what we're saying is that our hypothesis that will be very soon validated by the market is that if you use tokens instead of US dollars, and knowing about all these phenomena governing tokens, that there are these networks and they go up in value, that you can have new business models based on ranking using tokens, and tokens will become valuable just because people want to access this attention. And essentially, if some pools of attention globally, some communities, some groups of people will not be accessible for Doras anymore, you will not be able to pay Facebook to show them stuff. You will have to buy these tokens to show them this stuff. Suddenly you will have a scarcity, very valuable scarcity of attention of a very targeted people that is only accessible, that is no longer accessible for fiat currencies. You have to exchange fiat to get to them, because they will be kind of, their attention will be walled by these tokens. That's our hypothesis with this. Again, like, you know, this will be recorded, probably uploaded to YouTube in 2 years' time. You can come back to this video, and whatever I'm saying right now will be either validated or invalidated. That's the beauty of it. So, like, you know.
Okay, I have a question about blockchain. How do you see the blockchain in conjunction with European Union PSD2 directive? It will support it or stop it?
PSD2, could you remind me what that stands for?
It's about checking data and this data refreshing in every minute, so it stops cheating.
Okay.
It's a new directive.
Could you just give some background? You know, we are working like 20 hours a day on our projects and not monitoring what's going on elsewhere.
Okay, it's a new directive that will change, I think it's everything, because we have to check every data for 3 steps, and this data in every place that we have it, refreshing, so if you want to cheat and change data, it's impossible.
Okay, but what data? Like
every data you imagine.
So, like, every data you imagine is kept in three places.
Every data that you will have in a blockchain.
Is there really a directive of how to build blockchains by EU?
No, it's not about how to build the blockchain, but it changed a little bit blockchain.
Okay, I have no idea what exactly the directive is, but I think that perhaps it's not applicable maybe to systems like blockchain system-based systems, because it's basically there's, you know, there's no one entity that governs it and can check it, and there probably will be some kind of you know, interference between this the wording of this directive with actually how the blockchains work, its immutability, security. Basically, there's no plausible way of changing, frauding the data from the first principle for blockchain. So I don't think that this. Probably this directive was not created with blockchains in mind, and it would be indeed interesting to see how actually this it's interconnected and how it would influence, if at all, with blockchains. But I don't think that we have Julia has something.
Okay, I think this is not about everything, but about payment systems and banking. So this is like a fintech-related question, I believe. And like the problem, my problem here is that although blockchain is very often attributed to fintech, and this is correct because blockchain has a huge potential there, like what I particularly do has very little to do with fintech or nothing. So I'm not really able to answer this question. Apart from the fact that I do believe that using blockchain technologies you can revolutionize the banking systems, and projects like R3 or Ripple are already trying to do that. So also like I cooperate, but rather as an advisor, to Omise project, and what they do is also the plan to use blockchain technology as a database for banking, and then of course depending on the structure you can replicate that easily three times or four times or how many times you wish.
Okay, with that we'll end our meeting today. Thank you very much for coming. Please thank our guests the recording of this event will appear sooner or later on Dell Labs YouTube channel. Thank you very much.